always had a fascination for the sights and sounds and smells of the sea. I guess it's the big regenerative force in my life. It's a very frightening and awesome responsibility to have been chosen as National Teacher of the Year. I guess a chief fringe benefit, the most rewarding aspect, has been hearing from students I haven't seen in years. The wonderful, warm expressions of appreciation and thanks, about all a teacher could ask for. I remember once in a letter from a former student, Della. She thanked me for one day, one moment, when I left her free with her own mind, as she said, just to think. I understand her needs, I think. A lively game of charades triggers class interest.
Page 358. It's a Ferlinghetti poem. Cast up, the heart flops over, gasping love. A foolish fish which tries to draw its breath from flesh of air, and no one there to hear its death among the sad bushes, where the world rushes by and a blather of asphalt and delay. What, Al?
What's a foolish talk? Or blather
when blather is foolish talk, right. What? Yes, it's very distracting visually because this is a very visually impressive poem, isn't it? It isn't it really more a... sensed thing, felt thing, rather than a heard thing. Among the sad bushes. Are bushes sad? There is a term used in describing poetry called the pathetic fallacy. And the pathetic fallacy means that particular time when a poet or writer assumes that something inanimate feels something human. It's similar to...
In literature... And in the entire curriculum, the big thing is relevancy.
The bushes can indeed feel sad.
Can it mean something in their personal lives? Can the poem tap the personal consciousness of that individual student?
Right. Mm-hmm. And by contrast with the sincere emotion of the heart-gasping lover, the fish gasping for air, is the what of the world passing by?
Indifference.
The indifference.
The
foolish. I couldn't help, but when I discovered this poem last night, I couldn't help, of course, drawing the connection. And then, of course, the state highway of asphalt going by. And, of course, obviously people oblivious to the death and the sad bushes nearby. Any other comments, reactions?
How lucky I am to have a young lady like her on my staff. And not only Miss Goleman, but others of the fine group we have working here. The changes in Jackson during the past 10 years have been many and constant. It's moved from an all-white school to a nearly 50% Cuban refugee enrollment to an enrollment predominantly black. Our student body now is composed 97% of minority cultures. Along with these changes came many sociological problems, many adjustments, and many challenges that entailed outstanding work by teachers. Barbara's entire teaching career has been at Jackson. Her quiet enthusiasm, her warmth, her cooperation have helped build a special kind of team spirit as we work together here. It's an interesting area, Dade County or Greater Miami. Its school system is now the nation's seventh largest. During this past decade, many new award-winning schools have been built to house our mushrooming enrollment. There are more than 220 schools in Dade. Some enjoy the breezes of Miami Beach. Some are in the agriculture areas of Homestead. Some serve the industrial area of Hialeah. Some are in the quiet of suburbia, and some in the noise of the city. Barbara and others like her might be on the staff of any, or maybe on the staff of one of Florida's universities or colleges. I'm glad she decided that this place, this school, was her big challenge.
Okay, I can play.
Uh-huh. I got
D.
Yes, I am.
That's a double. That's a double.
Hey, how do you do? S-L-I-E, what's that? S-L-I-E.
Third, Eddie, level crossing. A spokesman from the railroad company said one of the trains apparently did not stop for a red light just outside of the railroad station. One train was going to Brussels, the other was to Ghent. The two heavy diesel engines crashed head on. Spokesman said several cars were
derailed.
Spokesman from the railroad company said one of the trains apparently did not stop for a red light just outside of the railroad station. One train was going to Brussels.
It's a tremendous challenge to a teacher today to find out just the right technique that will turn that particular student on, that will tap his interests. It seems so vitally important to me for the teacher to get involved in the thick of the action, to get close to the student, to hear his needs.
Remember the letter you wrote to Mr. Degani?
Oh, yeah. I have one in my book, I think.
Mm-hmm.
Uh-huh.
Thanking him for the field trips and requesting more field trips.
I hope he accepted that, and, you know, he'd give me a response to say yes, not no.
He said he hoped he'd be able to provide more field trips. And next year, hopefully, we're going to have some funding in order that we can have more field trips. I hope so.
Well, Miss Goleman, I was thinking of your class making up a club. Maybe, you know, all these little children on the street, to someday take them to the playground and, you know, have fun with them.
Have the class take them?
Yes, anybody at the class, just make up a little club or something.
That'd be nice. Where would you suggest that we get some of the kids?
Well, anybody who wanted to join the class could, you know, from any part of the school, I think it should be open.
And then after school, we could take them someplace like to a park?
Yes, I think they'll enjoy it because some of them just stay in the street all the time instead of being home.
It seems to me some of the greatest classrooms are outside the school building. In fact, just outside. After all, it seems to me that heightened awareness
is a chief aim of education.
What about the fruits and fruits?
Those trees that you see them standing up, but they call them custard apple.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah. And soon be ripe. I mean, soon be on there pretty soon.
Yes, in the spring.
Yeah.
What kind of apples do you call them?
Custard apples.
Custard apples.
Yeah.
They're real small. We call them Indian apples sometimes. They're hard, aren't they?
No. When it gets ripe, they're real.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
I guess I just tried them when they were green.
That's what the bears eat.
Yeah, bears eat those. Can you see that tree out there? The green one?
So many of you, I noticed Eugene, especially yesterday on the trip to the Everglades, mentioned that he loved to go out in the Everglades because suddenly he felt liberated. And I don't know, I always feel this way. I don't know if you did or not. There is just something about leaving the city, going to the fresh air and open spaces that tends to release one, liberate one. The city builds its horror in my brain. This writing is my only wings away. Let's hurtle back through a century or two, through time, to page 454, and there's something irresistible about young people. I hope I can keep tuning into their joy of discovery, their delight in sheer physical involvement, their eagerness to live fully. Does it take courage to dare to have fun in the experience of learning and living?